a place to dine, a glass of wine, a little late romance. It's a chain reaction. We'll see the people of the world coming out to dance, 'cause there's music in the air and lots of love and everywhere. So give me the night. Give me the night.
Hi, folks. Good afternoon to those of you watching us from Brazil. Good evening, friends who join us from Europe, from Portugal. Nice to have you here with us today. Allow me to provide you a reminder in Portuguese, just a little brief reminder.
Permitam explicar em português que nós vamos conduzir o nosso encontro todo em inglês.
Que é possível selecionar essa opção clicando no globo interpretação, certo? Well, folks, on behalf of the Marist Brothers and the Pastoral Service of our university, our Pontifical Catholic University, I want to welcome all of you to PUC, to our university. We come to you virtually this time with another edition of the traditional event Fé e Cultura, Faith and Culture. Usually you had to go to the buildings of a university, you know, you had to go to the actual buildings of a university to attend a lecture, a talk, a conference. Well, now it's the university that comes to you. It's the university that comes to your houses. Quite unusual, but thanks God, our technology allows us to do that. Today, we will reflect on the issue of meditation and its benefits in the context of social isolation, an experience much of us are having during this time of COVID-19. First of all, let me introduce myself. I'm João Fett, a member of the pastoral services staff here at PUC, and I am the presenter and one of the organizers of this event, together with Brother Marcelo Bonenberger and Rafael Rosseto. As I just said, I want to welcome all of you, and I want to explain in a few seconds how this online meeting works and how our conversation will develop, okay? So, we'll conduct it in English, at least for most of the time, but we have simultaneous interpretation, we have simultaneous translation at our disposal here in this webinar. So you can choose to listen to us in English or in Portuguese. You have just to click upon this icon down below here with a little globe called interpretation, and then you select the language you want, all right? Make sure that comments and questions are very welcome during all the meeting. Please write them through the chat box. You can also use the Q&A box also down here in our main box. And our staff will pick up your questions because we'll try to read some of them, at least some of them, during the Q&A, right? So please write your comments or questions during all the meeting because afterwards we'll pick them up. Notice also that a link will appear to you in the chat box in a few seconds, so that you can confirm your presence here and receive the certificate. But please notice that the certificates will be provided only to those that were previously enrolled in this event. Only to those that were previously enrolled in this event and who confirmed their presence today through the link I just mentioned. I think it will appear any moment in our chat box. Enough of technical details. Let me present to you our guest speaker, our dear guest speaker, Lawrence Freeman, or as we call him here, Don Lawrence. Many of you probably know him. Many of you surely know him from the community of meditation, Christian meditation. He is a British Benedictine monk. He was born in English, though he warned me that I should present him as Irish. He studied English literature at New College, Oxford University. He studied theology at the University of Montreal and at McGill University, which I think is in Canada, if I'm not much mistaken. He's the director of the World Community for Christian Meditation, following John Main's tradition. The community is now present in over 100 countries. He gives talks and retreats around the globe and is deeply committed to interreligious dialogue. Don Lawrence is also the author of many books. Among them, we should highlight the books Light Within, Selfless Self, and Your Daily Practice. And besides that, I want to add that he is a good buddy, a good pal. We had the opportunity to meet in person. We could get together in person. You all remember those times, don't you? We met last year at Pukin. Don Lawrence came to talk to us about meditation just a few days after we had inaugurated our room for meditation at Pukin, which is still active, though it's not receiving people due to the pandemic, due to COVID, but it's still active. And on that occasion, we had lunch together, we chatted, and we talked about meditation in the university sphere. It was quite nice. I want to also welcome Leonardo, member of the World Community for Christian Meditation staff. He is a partner of this event. The community is a partner of this event. Leonardo helped us a lot with the pre-meeting demands. So I should thank Leonardo very much. And last but not least, Maloney Rodriguez, the so-called meditation guy here at Pukin. That's how we call him here. That's how people call him here. Maloney does an incredible job here with so many initiatives regarding meditation, spirituality, and well-being. And the Maris brothers invested a lot in these initiatives because they regard spirituality and the self-development as a whole as a valuable thing. Well, our agenda for the next 1 hour will be the following. Don Lawrence will give his talk for around 20 minutes, maybe a little more. Afterwards, he will conduct a brief meditation practice so that we can experience the thing that we are talking about, meditation, Christian meditation. And then we'll have Q&A. We'll have some time for questions, comments, and to have a chat with Don Lawrence. Finally, Maloney will very briefly present some initiatives regarding meditation that we offer here at Pukin. Well, I've already talked way too much. Don Lawrence, it's great to have you here. Thank you for having accepted our invitation. The mic's yours. Passamos a palavra a Don Lawrence.
Thank you, Juan, very, very much indeed for your welcome. It's nice to see you again. Can you hear me okay? I take that to be yes. Okay. Thank you. Thanks. I remember my visit to Pukin last time and very happy connections and time that we spent together. I'm sorry I can't be there in person now with you. We all know why that is impossible. And what I'd like to do in this short meeting is to share with you something of the common anxiety and suffering that we are all facing in the world today because of the corona crisis. Different countries are feeling it, of course, with different levels of intensity. Even different parts of the same countries are experiencing it differently. The rich are experiencing it differently from the way the poor are experiencing it. But nevertheless, the corona COVID crisis has in a way unified the world. It's made us aware that we are one family, one species on this planet. And that may be one of the important benefits that will come out of this crisis, this remembering that we are one family and that we help each other or we perish individually and separately. I think one of the benefits that will come out of this may be that we are conscious of our environmental crisis and that this is not just a long-term thing. It's something that is happening now and calls for us to act with unity. But I'd like to start by just drawing attention to the fact that we are all suffering in different ways during this time. Many of you who are tuning in now to this session may be alone. You may have been at home or confined somewhere for a long time. And I was too. We still here in France where I'm living now. There are many restrictions, but I was more than 4 months in our center at Bonneveau in France, a meditation center and with the community there. In many ways, it was a good place to be locked up because it was a beautiful place with beautiful nature all around. And I was locked up with 12 very nice fellow prisoners with whom I was able to experience this challenge in a way that it was brought some surprising benefits. One of the benefits it brought us was to realize that we can share with people around the world some wisdom, some ancient wisdom, wisdom from our ancient wisdom traditions of how to deal with the suffering that we are confronting in this crisis. And I know from many people that I've spoken to over the past few months that some of the things that they feel, some of the ways they're suffering are fear. We're always frightened when we feel we're out of control. We don't know what is going to happen. Life is unpredictable. We don't know whether the people we love are going to be sick or whether we will be sick. And of course, we don't know what the financial situation will be like, the social situation after this epidemic is over. So there's a lot of fear. Also, I think at a personal level, many are very restless. They're not used to being locked up in one place. Anxious, anxiety, and loneliness. And by loneliness, I mean that it's the feeling of isolation, the feeling of being disconnected from other people at any meaningful, personal, human level. The feeling that emotionally and physically, you are not connected. And that what you are suffering, what you are going through is in a kind of separate universe. And there's no deep communication between you and other people. I think most human beings have experienced this kind of loneliness at different moments in their lives. But during this present crisis, loneliness has become rampant. It's become a very widespread virus, psychological virus, by itself. And I think we need to examine that. And if you have felt lonely in this sense of being isolated, cut off, disconnected, and frightened, then maybe what I can share with you this evening about a cure for loneliness will be of value to you. I hope it will be. One of the difficult things that all human beings face is themselves, to face ourselves, to really be ourselves. The famous French writer in the 18th century, Blaise Pascal, once wrote, "All the troubles in the world arise from the inability of people to sit alone in a room by themselves for 15 minutes." I think that was an insight into the difficulty that most of us feel at a certain point in our lives of facing ourselves, coming to self-knowledge. By this, I mean not just thinking about ourselves and planning what we're going to do tomorrow or how we're going to spend our money or spend our time, but I'm talking about a deeper connection with ourselves. And that is something that comes about when we can overcome this fear, the fear of being ourselves and the fear of being with ourselves. And that's what I mean by loneliness. And I think many people during this crisis have experienced this fear and this loneliness. Now, when normally we feel lonely, we may say, well, how am I going to get out of this feeling? Will I go to a party? Will I phone up some friends? Will I go to have dinner with some people? Will I get on chat line? Will I get on social media? Will I start connecting with people in these different social or digital ways? Well, I don't think that is a cure for loneliness. I think it's why, in fact, many people feel more lonely if they use social media or they use social activity only as an escape. If you're trying to escape what you're feeling, then it will get worse. That's, I think, universal experience. So the cure for loneliness is not a lot of activity, but stillness. The cure for loneliness is not increasing the noise level in our minds, increasing the amount of mental activity and messaging and texting, but silence. And as soon as we begin to discover that, and many people around the world that I've been in touch with have benefited from this difficult and painful time by rediscovering themselves, by coming to self-knowledge. It didn't happen in a way that they liked, but it was a real benefit that came out of this crisis and this confinement for many people. Our community started a website in English called A Spiritual Path Through the Crisis. And we've received a huge response to that. And we still are. And what we were trying to do was to share with people the possibility of seeing a spiritual path and a spiritual meaning in the midst of all of this crisis and the loneliness and suffering it was causing. Now, what this comes down to saying is, the cure for loneliness is solitude. Now, the word solitude is, let me define it in the way that I'm using it. It's not quite what you might find in the Portuguese or the English dictionary. As I said, loneliness is this feeling of being isolated, disconnected, frightened, emotionally separate. Solitude has a different meaning. Solitude means that we discover who we truly are. We come to self-knowledge in the spiritual dimension. Not just by talking to other people or to ourselves, but by being ourselves in that time of silence and stillness that I was talking about a minute ago. And that will bring us to discuss meditation in a few minutes. So I hope the point I'm making is coming across clearly. During this time of crisis, many of us have felt at times intense loneliness and fear. And the cure for this is not to just increase our mental activity, but to be still, to be silent, and at times, not 24 hours a day, but to be still and silent at certain moments of the day. And that will lead us into solitude, which is the discovery of who we are. And there's a wonderful discovery to be made when we discover our own uniqueness. That God has created each one of us as an absolutely unique manifestation of the divine being. We are not produced in a factory like millions of iPhones, all exactly the same. Each one of us is a lot, is much greater than just an identical computer. We are an absolutely unique, special, cannot be reproduced, cannot be cloned, manifestation of the divine love. And that's what I mean by solitude. And when we feel the first fruits, the first benefits of this solitude, just by sitting in stillness for a little bit, and just by being silent for a little bit, we begin to feel connected with ourselves, with our true selves, with our deeper selves. And that means that we are able to accept and recognize that, yes, I'm feeling lonely, I'm feeling frightened, I'm feeling very restless, I don't know what's going to happen, I'm feeling depressed, yes. But my deeper self, my true self, is another kind of experience. And this is what I mean by solitude being the cure for loneliness, because we have become connected with ourselves. In the ancient world, there was an understanding that gave great meaning to life, that they called the chain of being, the great chain of being. It meant that everything was connected, from the smallest ant to God, through all of the levels of biology and of nature, of creation. Everything was connected. Of course, there are billions and billions and billions of different things, different organisms. And today, as we understand the subatomic level of reality in nature, the sense of being connected is becoming important again for us, because we know that everything happens because we are connected. It is connected to, everything is connected to something else. And so, when we enter into silence and solitude, we are first of all becoming connected to ourselves. And that is the missing link. If we are not connected to ourselves, then we cannot feel connected to other people, to the world around us, to our environment, or to God. And it's this experience of connection that gives meaning to our life. And I mean that even when in this pandemic, we often think, what does it all mean? What is it? Is it meaningless? What is coming out of this crisis, this chaos? But if we feel connected at this fundamental level to ourselves, then we will begin to feel connected to everything else. And if we lose that connection with our true self, with our spirit, with ourselves as an image of God, then we are in a real crisis. That is the spiritual crisis that underlies a lot of our problems today. So meditation, this is what meditation is about. Meditation is simply allowing ourselves for a short period of time every day to be in silence and to be in stillness, to let go of our fear and of our anxiety or our loneliness, and instead to begin to feel connected to the wonder of our own being, connected to our own spirit. I've been meditating for more than 40 years. And what I would like to share with you from that experience is one idea. Meditation is not complicated. Meditation is simple. It isn't easy, but what is easy in life? Anything meaningful is going to present us with a challenge. But meditation is simple, and this is why children love to meditate, and why we must really learn how to teach children to meditate. If we want to change the world, we should teach children to meditate in every school in Brazil, in every school in the world. The other thing that I have learned through these years of meditation, and all these years I have been part of a community, is that meditation creates friendship. It creates a community of love. I don't mean a perfect community, nothing is perfect, but it has created a most amazing sense of connection between people who are on the same path meditating together. And it's this experience of friendship, spiritual friendship, between people who meditate together and the community in which they meditate, which supports them, that I think is one of the great benefits that we can discover, any of you can discover, if during this time of crisis, you set aside a little time every morning and every evening just to be still, just to be silent. So I'd like to say a few words now about how we meditate, and this is a very simple method, a universal method. As a monk myself, I've learned this through my own Christian monastic tradition, through my teacher, John Main, Irish Benedictine monk. And it's this that is being taught in all our meditation groups around Brazil and around the world. It's a very simple method, but it is a very powerful and transformative way of coming to meaning and to this sense of connection. So there's one simple idea, one single and simple idea or experience that links all of these things that I've been talking about together. And that is attention, learning to pay attention. Maybe your attention span is beginning to weaken a little bit as I've been talking for 20 minutes. So I'll stop talking, but before you tune off entirely from what I'm saying, just listen to this very simple method of learning to pay attention. Attention is what makes us human. Attention is what allows us to love. To pay attention to another person is to love them. To pay attention to our own true self is to learn how to love and accept ourselves. Attention is a work of love because we take the focus off ourselves, off our ego, off our problems, and we turn to another. This is a liberation, a freedom from the ego. Ultimately, we may do this with the people we love in the world. We may do it with people who need something that we can give them. And ultimately, it is prayer. This is the essence of prayer, the meaning of the prayer of the heart, as Jesus taught it. Jesus tells us when you pray, go into your room, your inner room, your heart, and pray in that secret, that mysterious place. So the work of meditation that we're going to do now, you could say is the work of attention. Just simply learning to pay attention. And we all have to learn that because we're all very distracted. So don't be surprised or disappointed when you discover how distracted you are when we meditate now for a few minutes. Let me just ask you to do this, to enter into a little bit of stillness and silence together with all the few hundred people who are on this session together. So first of all, however you're sitting, try to sit with your back straight. That will help you to be alert and stay awake. If you're sitting on a chair, put your feet on the ground and put your hands on your lap or on your knees. So you begin with your body, begin meditation physically. Relax your shoulders, relax the muscles of your face, your forehead, where we get a lot of tension, and our neck and shoulders. So just loosen up and relax, but be alert. And then close your eyes lightly. And just be aware of your breathing for a few moments. Just feel the breath coming in and coming out and going out. That cycle of breathing that accompanies us for the whole of our life. We don't normally think about it, just be aware of it for a few moments. And this will help to calm the mind and to take the attention off your thoughts. And this is what meditation is about. Taking the attention off our thoughts. So let's put it this way. Meditation is not what you think. That doesn't mean that we're not thinking. We're thinking of our problems. We're thinking of the news. We're thinking of the future. We're thinking of what we're going to have for dinner tonight. We're thinking of what's on TV, we're thinking of what we're studying, what's going to happen. Of course, thoughts will be flowing through our mind like a like the Amazon River. But we can take the attention off our thoughts. And that is the way to make the connection with our deeper, true self. That's what I mean by solitude and meaning and attention. So, how do we take the attention off our thoughts? Very simply, we take a word, a single word, a prayer word, a mantra, a meditation word, and we repeat this one word during the time of the meditation. The word I'm going to recommend to you is the oldest Christian prayer. It means come Lord. The word, however, is not Portuguese or English. It's Aramaic, the language that Jesus spoke. And it's the oldest prayer in the Christian tradition. If you choose this word, which I would recommend, the word is Maranatha. Maranatha. Four syllables. Maranatha. You repeat the word in your mind, in your heart, and give your full attention to the word as you repeat it. And when thoughts come into your mind, you let go of the thoughts and come back to the word. That's what I mean by being very simple. That's why children can meditate. So again, let's just take a moment to sit upright with your back straight. Close your eyes lightly. Sit relaxed but alert. And then gently, silently, without moving your lips or your tongue, begin to sound and say the word interiorly. The word again is Maranatha. 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 Just begin to say it and say it faithfully. Say it without force. Say it gently, but say it faithfully. And when you get distracted, which will be a lot of the time, just let go of the thoughts and, like a child, come back to your word. So we'll meditate now for just under 15 minutes, which I'll time with my timer on the app that our community does. And we'll meditate together in friendship and in peace. Let's end the meditation now with these words from Jesus in the Gospel of John. Peace is my gift to you, my parting gift to you. My own peace, such as the world cannot give. Set your troubled hearts at rest and let go of your fears. I've spoken these words to you so that my joy may be in you and your joy may be complete. Good.
Thank you, Don Lawrence, for these timely reflections and for this meditation practice we could experience. Really, it transmits calmness, peacefulness. It's built upon a peaceful message, the gospel, the message of the gospel, Maranatha, right? Thank you very much. So friends, now we have time for questions and comments. We had some already. Please write them through the chat box. You read the first one, and afterwards, Leonardo will read another one. So, Don Lawrence, the first question we selected is this. You began your talk talking about the need to face ourselves, you know, the need to seize this moment, to get some self-knowledge, to get something out of it. That's surely a good advice for us. But some people are facing troubles from inside and from the outside, as you know, of course. So I think this question touches that point. I'll read the question for you. So the question is this. During this time of social isolation, many people have experienced much suffering due to different causes. Some people are struggling with health issues. Some are having a hard time regarding their finances. Some lost their jobs, and so on. You said meditation might help us to overcome feelings of anxiety and fear. What would you say to those people whose minds cannot be silenced? It seems that they cannot be put to rest. How to calm down when pressures are so high?
Thank you. That's a very important question and useful question. Thank you for raising it. First of all, we cannot change events. We're not in control of events. But we can change, and we can, in a sense, be in control of our own response to events. Now, sometimes we feel overwhelmed, of course, when suffering is very great or we are confronted with a shock, we feel overwhelmed. But after this feeling of being overwhelmed and in chaos, we can recover a sense of balance. And in fact, we can recover a deeper sense of connection with our own true self, even through suffering and painful external events. Now, of course, to do that, we have to want to do it, and we need the help of others, and we need to be determined to find our way through the anxiety and the turmoil of our thoughts and of our emotions and our fears to that deeper peace that Jesus was talking about, which is already in us. Now, I have to say, you know, meditation is not a magic pill. Meditation doesn't solve all the problems of the world in a moment. If we have a pandemic raging around Brazil and some chaos about how to deal with it, meditation, it doesn't suddenly change all of that. I wish it did, but it's really leaders, politicians, and ourselves who have to change those things. But what meditation can do is, of course, to change the way that we look at those problems and deal with the emotions and the anxiety that they create. And meditation in that respect is very powerful. It allows us to come back into some, over time, it doesn't happen immediately, but if you set aside a little time every morning and every evening to meditate, you will begin to feel this sense of connection with the peace of Christ, the Spirit within yourself. And that will change the way that you look at these problems that we're facing. And it will give you a new kind of peace to be able to deal with the emotions that you're feeling. Now, and also to do that, I think it's very important to have the friendship and the support of other people on this spiritual path that you will be following. If you meditate every day, you are on a spiritual path to your own heart. But it's a path where we naturally need support and friendship. And that's why meditation groups have formed and why during this particular crisis, we have thousands of online meditation groups. Leonardo Correa in Porto Alegre is our director of communications, and he's been very busy in the last few months helping people set up online meditation groups. And he, I'm sure, will be very happy to advise you about how to make connections with one of those groups. But that's how I would respond to the question. Meditation is not magic, but it is a way of faith. And if you remember what it says in the gospel, faith moves mountains.
Exactly. Sure. Thank you very much. Before Leonardo raises another question, I just want to mention that many people liked your analogy or comparison between our thoughts in the Amazon River. Many people find the metaphor accurate.
Yes.
Yeah. Leonardo.
Okay, there is a question about if meditation is for everyone or if there are situations that is not recommended.
Well, as I said, I have been meditating for a long time, and I've been asked that question many times. My honest answer is, I do believe that meditation is for everyone. That doesn't mean that everybody can meditate immediately. It takes some people longer to learn, to get into a practice. It took me a few years to develop a regular practice. But I do believe it is for everybody. And you can see this, for example, in the classroom of children. Children will one day be, you know, they're very, every one of them is unique, as I was saying. They're all different. Some of them can sit and meditate for the first time, and it's as if they were, had been meditating for years. Others are more restless, you know, more agitated, and it takes them longer. But eventually, when they meditate together, and they have a good teacher, it won't be long before they are all actually meditating together. So that is an example, I think, if you apply that globally to the 6 billion people in the world, I would say that, of course, everyone is different, will respond to this differently, but essentially it's the same message. Now, you may find that you can't meditate for 20 minutes or 15 minutes or 10 minutes. You may find you can only do it for 5 minutes. Well, start with 5 minutes, but gradually build up to 15 or 20. But be patient, but be regular. Now, many people say, I have a problem with discipline. Well, so do I. But that's where community comes in, friendship comes in, where you have, if you're connected to a regular group, then that group will help you to develop a discipline in your personal life. So the first question is, can you understand a little bit of what meditation means? Meditation is not what you think. If you can just begin to understand that, you can start to meditate. Of course, you have to take it on trust at first, but your own experience will teach you very quickly. And if you have the support and the friendship of others, you'll be surprised how much progress you can make in a relatively short time.
I don't know, João, how we are with time.
Yeah, we can continue a little bit.
Okay. So I will make go ahead.
Yeah, maybe I would just comment, just share the comment of one of our participants here. Elena, she says, I could not tell the differences between what Buddhism says in your words in terms of meditation. I think, how do you explain, how do you conceive meditation in a Christian way, right? So she thinks that there are lots of similarities that Leonardo.
I was going to pack three questions, very practical, Lawrence. Is if we should synchronize the breath with the mantra, and if we should do, instead of 15, 30 minutes is better than 15, and if we should do a reading, a religious reading, before or after meditation.
Sorry, I only heard the first part of the question, which I'll answer, about synchronizing the breath during the meditation with the repetition of your mantra, your word. Yes, I think most people do find that helpful and natural. You could, for example, say the mantra as you breathe in, ma, ra, na, tha, and breathe out in silence. Or if that's not comfortable, you could say, for example, the first two syllables, ma, ra, as you breathe in, and na, tha, as you breathe out. I think that will help to get you into a rhythm, but eventually you'll find that the word establishes its own rhythm. So don't divide your consciousness, your mind, between the breath and the word. Give your full attention, listen to the word as you say it. But after a while, I think you'll find that the mantra finds its own rhythm with the breath. But remember, your breath is going to slow down during meditation because you'll be becoming more relaxed. So keep the attention on the word rather than on the breath. But let the breath carry the word for you, especially at the beginning of the meditation. The other two questions I couldn't quite hear. The audio isn't so good. What were they?
It was if it is recommended to do a religious reading before or after meditation. And and about the timing, if they recommended 15 or 30 minutes.
Okay. Well, I kept you know the instructions this evening very very simple, but it is natural if you pray in other ways, and meditation is a way of prayer. It's the prayer of the heart. It can be integrated with other kinds of prayer, as we do at Bon Vaux, with the Divine Office, morning, midday, and evening, and with the Mass. We meditate during the Mass after Communion. So if you pray already in other ways, through in words, in scripture, then you can easily begin the meditation with a short scripture reading, or maybe a chant or a little music, and then go into the meditation, and then or maybe read the gospel of the day in the morning after the meditation, for example. So you can find your own little ritual or routine, and you'll find that very enriching. Meditation opens opens you to a deeper understanding of the meaning of scripture. Because you meditate, you will be able to read the word of God as something alive and active. In terms of how long to meditate for, as I said, it depends a bit on the individual. I would recommend trying to start with 20. Many people today may find that is too long, but I would say try 20 and build up to 30 over a period of time. But if you find that's starting too much, too soon, then you can start with 15 or even 10 minutes or even 5. Some people who are very stressed and with a lot of emotions churning inside of them will, you know, may find at first it's very difficult to sit still, even physically, for 5 minutes or 10 minutes or 15 minutes. So do what you can, but I would advise you to experiment a little and then set a fixed time. For example, if you say, I can't do 15 minutes, I can do 10 minutes to begin with. Okay, perfect. Set your alarm, your timer for 10 minutes. And then gradually increase it little by little, up to 15 and up to 20. The point is, you see, that it takes a certain amount of time. I mean, I think it takes about 10 minutes just for the mind to begin to calm down and detach from whatever intellectual or physical activity you have been doing before the meditation. You can't just change channels like you can on a TV or a computer. So it takes time just for the mind to begin to slow down and calm down. And then in a way, your meditation can begin more deeply, more fruitfully, when the mind has become a bit calmer. But if you're just beginning, then do what you can do, 5 minutes, 10 minutes, but time it and do it on a regular basis.
We're running out of time, but maybe a short one, Leonardo?
Yeah, I don't know if it's a short one, but it is a very common question that this person says that meditation is very related with the Eastern, you know, religions, and how it makes the connection with the Catholicism or Christianity.
Okay. Well, I think that's, again, a very important question, because when I was brought up as a Catholic boy at school, I was never introduced to meditation. I was taught other ways of prayer, and I was taught the Mass, and I loved these other forms of prayer. But I was not introduced to this prayer of the heart. Now that's quite an important something to miss. Because when you look at the teaching of Jesus on prayer, you will find this is what he teaches. Go into your inner room, he says, your heart. He tells us not to use many words. To remember that God knows your needs before you ask. So prayer is not just about shooting off 1,000 different requests to God, or just about expressing your desires. Then he tells us, do not worry at the time of prayer. And he tells us, set your mind upon God's kingdom, be single-minded, be calm. And he tells us, be in the present moment, don't worry about tomorrow. Now, when you take these teachings of Jesus on prayer, what you have is a teaching on contemplation. Jesus is a teacher of contemplative prayer, or the prayer of the heart. This is what he teaches. And as now, in recent years, the church has been recovering this contemplative dimension of faith, of prayer, of theology, and also discovering that contemplation and action have to go together. We are called by the nature of our faith to speak and act against injustice or deception and cruelty. We have to speak out and act against that. We're human beings. But in order to do that wisely and effectively, we have to make sure that our action comes out of our contemplation. That's the gospel, this mixture of contemplation and action. And Jesus gives us these two elements. So, it's necessary for us today. The church is in a crisis, like many other parts of the world. And the crisis is sending us back to the heart of the gospel. And we need to become a contemplative church. That means that ordinary people like ourselves are invited to develop a contemplative aspect to our prayer and to our life. And a great revolution is happening as more and more men and women around the world are discovering that. And if this pandemic if it only does one thing, and that is to send more Catholics and members of other churches back to the gospel and to develop a contemplative dimension of prayer in their lives, their daily lives, then one day we will even be grateful for that.
Excellent. So it's about keeping it simple and acting out of the heart, right?
Right.
Well, folks, unfortunately, we ran out of time, so we won't be able to raise any more questions to you, Lawrence. But those questions that were already written here, we'll try to send them to him by email. Perhaps they will inspire him to write something or to maybe examine some aspects of this whole issue meditation in times of social isolation. Now it's time for us to share with you this poll. It's an assessment poll that will appear on your screen. We would like you to answer it so that we can improve our dynamics for the next events. So please answer to the poll. We appreciate your feedback very much. Everyone who is watching this live, thank you so much. You'll find this whole conversation on PUC-RS Pastoral Service YouTube channel in a few days, probably. Leonardo, thank you very much. PUC staff, Raquel and Michael, thank you very much for today. Don Lawrence, it was really great, really good to have you here again, though virtually, but it was excellent. Thank you for taking the time. As a British, I learned that you would prefer call yourself an Irish, but as a British, I would say marvelous conversation. So hope we can replay it sometime in the future. Stay safe and healthy. Greetings from us. Greetings from Brazil. With confidence, we will overcome these hard times.
Thank you, Juan, for your work and your care and concern for the people that you're serving and for arranging this this session, which I hope will be helpful and fruitful to many. And thank you for all the good work that you're doing.
Thank you. Till next time. Malone, é contigo.
Olá, eu sou o Malone Rodrigues, trabalho aqui na universidade e foi uma alegria. Alô? Nós gostaríamos de convidar vocês que se interessam e querem aprofundar o conhecimento sobre meditação. Nós aqui da Universidade, da Pastoral da Universidade, estamos oferecendo inúmeras atividades formativas e vivenciais. Vocês podem acessar mais informações sobre essas atividades no site da Pastoral da Universidade, pucrs.br/pastoral. Lá vocês vão conhecer as nossas iniciativas de meditação que nós estamos oferecendo para toda a nossa comunidade. Muito obrigado, se vocês puderem, fiquem em casa.